Hello.
Hello.
Hi, how are you? Good
Hi,
to see
Joel.
you.
How are you doing? Good to see you.
So, how are things in South Africa?
It's winter here, so I see I'm
Oh
wearing
yeah.
winter clothes.
How winter is it?
Now it's very cold, so we have 10 degrees during the day, 12, and 1 at night, so.
Oh
And there's no central heating here, so
Oh, that's a bit of a problem.
at home it's very cold. But hopefully it's going to be another couple of weeks.
But you have got some electric heating or something, or
Not really, no. Well, it's very expensive to heat the places here.
okay.
So we basically pretend that winter doesn't exist for
Okay.
6 weeks a year.
I mean, here
How
the
is
summer
it?
isn't much better than the winter sometimes. We had all the temperatures about 12, 13 degrees last week, and but then I switched on the heating, even though it's summer. I don't really care, you know. I don't like it cold.
I see. And what is the COVID situation in Nottingham now?
Yeah, Nottingham, I mean, is doing pretty good so far. Just, and I'm actually living in Mansfield, which is a little city, and it's even less. It's even the best. I think Nottinghamshire is one of the best areas in England, and this is one of the best areas in Nottinghamshire. So it's yeah, hopefully. You're pretty safe, but it's obviously must be the same for you. It's a bit boring, and
Yeah, we are completely cut off from the rest of the world because no
yeah.
international travel is allowed. So we are stuck at home.
Yeah, I quite like to do lots of traveling. I mean, and this is a bit of a, but I seem to be okay with it. I don't know. I'm sort of surviving it so far. So yeah, that's better. But we'll see. I've got lots of dogs. They may make a noise at some point because my wife breeds dogs, and so she does.
Not a problem.
Yes, so you want to know more about intuitionistic logic, but I just realized you know lots of stuff already, right?
Not really. And look, and my view is very peculiar. Your view might be very different from mine.
That's always possible. Okay, I also have a whiteboard, so we can write something on my whiteboard. I can write something on
Yeah.
my whiteboard. But maybe first of all, yeah, I mean, I know that you were, I mean, you worked on modal logic, and that's a way to talk. I mean, tell me if I say something wrong. It's about epistemic things. I mean, no, I would think to me, logic of knowledge and belief. These are modalities, right?
It can be,
Yeah,
it
I mean
can be.
would be my motivation for modal logic. But while there are some sort of overlaps, I mean we both, I mean they use Kripke semantics for both of them, and there is this encoding using modal logic. For me, intuitionistic logic is very different because the idea is to capture reasoning in general, and in particular about mathematical constructions. Yeah, so it's not in any sense epistemic. It's not about beliefs or knowledge, but it's about facts, right? Mathematical statements. So it's a in a way universal logic. It's where you start. Yeah, I mean. When I do if I want to do modal logic, I would look at modal logic from my intuitionistic point of view, right? I mean it's always there. It's where you start, right? And so most people start with classical logic. And I had some people get very angry if you tell them that you, don't accept excluded middle, and they shout at you and they say, are you too stupid to understand it? Yeah. And it's funny. I find I get lots of, even by people who are not like this, they think it's a bit strange. It's a bit of, yeah, a bit religious. Yeah. Which is always a funny thing is if you're not on the mainstream, then you're religious. But if you're on the mainstream, then everything is fine. There's a bit of an asymmetry here. Yeah. Okay. But anyway, I'm not complaining. I'm just observing. Okay. So why am I funny, and why do I have this weird? Why do I prefer this weird logic? Yeah. And I've been obviously thinking about it. And there are two issues which are important to me. The first one is this, well-known observation. But let me explain it. It's what's called Platonism, whatever this means. So I find it, so we have this idea about the real world. The way we understand the real world, there are some facts. Here's a bottle that stands on the table, yeah? And these facts are either true or false. Okay, this is a la Wittgenstein, yeah? The world is everything which is the case, yeah, sort of thing. And we accept that facts are true or false, even if you don't know them, right? If I can make a precise statement about there are 52 stones in my garden, more obviously, then this is either true or false, even though I haven't checked it, right? So that's, it doesn't matter. This is this idea of realism. And then this idea is that when we do mathematical constructions in our head, and we talk about mathematical objects like numbers or sets and so on, that they're somehow like real world objects, yeah? That they also behave like this. So even they're somehow there, and anything we can say about them is either true or false, yeah? And I don't buy this, because this is somehow fundamentally different. These are things which we make up in our head, and they're not real. And although often we don't actually know exactly what we mean. We have to explain things. So, for example, the continuums hypothesis, is it true or false? Does this question make sense? Because in the end, it actually depends on what exactly you mean by a set, and having different ideas of what a set is leads to different answers. Yeah. So this whole idea that there is this the world of ideas, and everything is there, doesn't really work for me. Yeah. And hence I think instead of working with this strange idea of truth, maybe there's something better. And there is. This is actually very simple. For every proposition, for every statement I make, I'm going to explain what it needs to convince me of it. Yeah. So I say, oh, here's a statement, and here is the evidence. That's what you have to do to convince me of the statement. Yeah. And this sort of removes the need to refer to truth. Instead, you talk about evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And so the proposition as types explanation follows from this, because we can do this in a systematic fashion, right? So we can assign to every proposition the type of evidence. Yeah. For example, if you want me convince me of P and Q, you better give me a pair of evidence for P and evidence for Q. Yeah? And if you want to convince me that P implies Q, you better give me a machine, which if I call function, if I feed it evidence for P, it will output evidence for Q. And I can look at this function and convince myself that it's doing exactly this, yeah, and so on, yeah. So this is this evidence semantics, proposition as types. There are some people talk about the Curry Howard equivalent. I don't like this term, because it sort of suggests that there is this two things, logic and let's say lambda calculus, and they are sort of, by some miracle, they are related, yeah. And I rather think it's an explanation, yeah. Is how do I explain the meaning of a proposition? I explain it by giving a type of evidence. So this is the propositions as type explanation, yeah.
So this ultimately goes back to the probability semantics, right? From
So the problem is history is sort of things have been invented in various ways, and I'm not sure that they have been always put in the way I would like to put them, yeah. I mean, I don't want to say anything against Gödel, obviously, yeah. But that's not necessarily how I think, yeah. So probability, yes, to me always feels very syntactic, yeah. And the proposition as types explanation is something to me entirely semantic, yeah. So okay, I need some basic notions, like I need to understand what are tuples and what are functions and so on, but these are semantic objects. And I'm explaining propositions via mapping them to these semantic objects. Right? That once you do this, that very naturally suggests some rules, which like natural deduction and so on, which are inspired, you could say, by this probability semantics. That's not the way I view it. Yeah. I mean,
main reason I asked about that is that lots of people who work intuitionistic logic from the model logic point of view,
yeah,
like to point out that those probability interpretations have never been shown to be adequate.
Yes.
So they're incomplete.
Yes.
So therefore, there's this idea that this whole enterprise of justifying intuitionistic logic as the logic of evidence doesn't really work, because purely mathematically it doesn't work out. And that then they resolve to this Kripke semantics that is rather epistemological than what you're talking about.
Yes, that's true. So the sort of naive semantics, I mean, this propositionist types semantics, which in a way it maps everything to what it means, is not complete. Yeah, I mean, so this is a fundamental incompleteness. Whereas in classical logic, you propositional logic is complete, right? You can either prove or disprove every statement. Yeah. But that's not true if you in intuitionistic logic talk about intuitionistic logic, right? So for example, the rule of excluded middle is not provable, but it's also not refutable. Indeed, you can prove the double negation. So it means it certainly is not refutable, but it's also not provable. So in this sense, there is this incompleteness where we say, okay, there are statements for which I don't have positive or negative evidence. But as we know, that always happens, right? So,
But there's another type of incompleteness, right? If you purely consider Hilbert-style calculus, for example, for Huyting's calculus, right? Then there are formulas that are true in every probability interpretation of Gödel, but they are not derivable, right? Is that correct?
I'm not sure.
It's another way around. They're derivable sentences that are not valid according to the Gödel semantics, probability semantics.
Okay. In the semantics I suggest, which is this proposition as type. So maybe I don't know enough about this Gödel stuff. Yeah. So I'm not pretending to say anything about it. But for the proposition as types explanation, that's not the case. Everything which is provable is all those. That's a sound, right?
And the other way around.
No, it's not complete, right?
It's not complete.
You know, that's also not true. You cannot prove that it's complete. Okay. Yeah, and the example is just what I gave, right? I mean, the example is a classical true statement, like excluded middle, which is not provable. I mean, you can also use Pierce formula or whatever. It's not provable, but you cannot, because if you try to refute it with the semantics, you cannot prove P or not P. Can you prove the negation? No, because actually the double negation is provable. But obviously you cannot prove P or not P, because that would mean that everything is decidable in the semantics. Yeah? To prove P or not P means you get either give evidence for P or you give counter evidence for P. And actually, okay, so first of all, you may not know, you may have a proposition P of which you don't know whether it's true or not true. So you cannot do this, I mean, in a sense. But even worse, actually, if you prove a state, the propositions are like black boxes, so you cannot look into them. So basically, you have to prove or disprove a proposition without ever looking at the proposition. And that is not possible, I mean, clearly, right? But the problem is, if we just use this naive semantics, then we have the same problem on the meta level. Yeah? I mean, P or not P is basically translated as P or not P. And on the meta level, we cannot prove or disprove this either, right? If our language of proposition is powerful enough. Right? So it's not a defect, actually. I would say it's the nature of things, right? It's not the case that for everything you should have evidence or counter evidence. This is exactly what intuitionism is about, right? So it's not really such a strange thing, right? We can come up with a better semantics. And I'm not sure that it has to be justified by the sort of model logic idea. So there's, first of all, there is Kripke semantics, which is actually related to what's called pre-sheaves, if you come from category theory. But Kripke semantics is not complete either, actually. Most people don't know this, because it is, so when you prove completeness of Kripke semantics, you can prove it first of all very easily for implication, conjunction, and true. But as soon as you introduce false or disjunction or existential, okay, actually for all it works as well, but as soon as you introduce one of these operations, it becomes first of all very difficult. And why is this? Okay, so if you prove completeness, how do you prove completeness? I guess you know, but let me just remind you. So you construct a universal model, yeah. So you use provability itself to construct a Kripke model. So the worlds are the context, and the provability relation is the order on the world. And then a world forces a proposition if the proposition is provable in this world. Right? And then you establish that provability in general, I mean, not just for atomic formula, you establish that provability and forcing, yeah, I mean, the relation in this model coincides, yeah, they're logically equivalent, and you do this by induction over the formulas, and from this it's then easy to derive completeness. But if you put in disjunction, that fails, right? Because you would say, from a context, let's say gamma, we prove. Shall I start writing or something? Or,
probably would help.
Yeah. Okay. Let me. How do I do this actually? Huh? Oh yeah. Share screen. Here we are. Okay. Yeah. Okay. And now I go. I just realized that my whiteboard just has itself switched off. Okay. So first of all, let me remind you what the Kripke model is. We have a pre-ordered set of worlds. Can you see this?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And then we have this relation, which is basically given a world, given an atom. I just write this. Does this make sense? Or
yes.
Okay. And then we can extend this relation to arbitrary propositions, right? Let's say formula, not to confuse. So like, I mean, as you know, A implies B is defined as for all W prime, which are the future, which is written on the left here. If W prime, okay, sorry, this has to be antitune. I should have mentioned this. Okay, so if this is the case, then but you know all this. I'm just writing this. Okay, and now we construct a universal model, which is a model where provability and truth coincides. And what do we use? We use the world as just a set of context, like gamma, which are basically conjunction of formulas, right? And the relation, so gamma lesser equal delta, is just provability. Now I have to get this direction right, but I hope, yeah. So gamma proves delta, I hope it's the right direction. I easily get confused by this, but because for example, gamma dot A proves gamma, and gamma dot A is the future of gamma. Okay, that should be okay. And now we establish the following in this model. We have to say what is the atomic forcing. So atomic forcing is just provability. Yeah? Does this make sense what I'm writing?
I think so, yes.
Okay, you think so. That mm-hmm. doesn't sound very... So I write here, this I write for this gamma is just the sequence of propositions and entails A, yeah, proves A. Mm-hmm. A is here an atom. A is an atom. Yeah. But now we can actually show, this is the essential step, the essential lemma to prove completeness is that for all propositions, not just for atomic one, this relation holds. P is a formula, so for any formula, in particular also for implication, right? And that's an interesting exercise. It's quite fun to prove this. So by induction on P, on the structure of the proposition.
What exactly do you mean by context?
Oh, okay. So when I present let me see, where can I do this? Okay, I need a new page. Okay, so when I present intuitionistic logic, I have this relation here, the provability, which is a relation between what I call context, a formula, okay,
mm-hmm.
and a context is a sequence of formula. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is it's a conjunction of these formulas. So for example, we can so the rule for introducing implication, if you assume A, you can prove B from assuming A, then you can prove A implies B, right?
So it's a set of formulas basically.
A sequence, okay? Yeah.
Sequencing.
Okay. And on the other hand, we have this gamma A the modus ponens, right? But yes, we need some other rules. You can work with sets or multi-sets, but I think I'm more comfortable with sequences, so you need something like this. Gamma A proves A, right? And if gamma proves B, then gamma dot A also proves B. So this is zero and this is weakening. This is arrow introduction and this is arrow elimination. There is a more canonical representation where you actually, instead of using arrow elimination, you make this bidirectional, the introduction rule. But then you need some structural rule to deal with context. So for example, you need the rule, like a cut rule. If gamma, you need a derivability for, oh yeah, okay. If gamma proves delta and delta proves A, then gamma proves A. So it's a cut.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, I haven't, so you also have to explain when, how, a context implies another context, and this is just by reading the second context as a conjunction. So it's basically gamma proves a zero a one till a n. If gamma proves a zero, gamma proves a one, and up to gamma proves a n. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And context doesn't have to be finite, right?
It does have to be finite, yeah. Just finite sequences. So everything is completely syntactic. Everything is very easy to reason about.
So, sorry, gamma has to be finite, right?
Yeah. The gamma is a sequence, a finite sequence, or a list, you could say, of formulas. And formulas are just these trees, right?
Okay. And that's how do you construct then the universal model out of this?
Okay, I just tried to do it here. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So the universal model, the words are the context, these finite sequences.
Okay.
Okay. The relation between these contexts is exactly probability. Or maybe inverse probability. I hope I haven't. And the relation, the forcing relation, is the provability. And actually, if you think about it, you want in the forcing relation, you want if gamma is less or equal to delta, and if delta forces A, then gamma forces A. Right? That's the anti-tone behavior, and if you plug in the semantics, So you replace this with turnstile, this with turnstile, and this with turnstile. Then you get exactly this cut rule, which I have already pointed out. Right? So that's fine. So antitone behavior of the lesser equal relation follows just from the cut rule. Right? And okay, transitivity also follows from the cut rule, the generalization for context. And reflexivity, okay, you need an identity rule. You need a rule here this follows from this definition that gamma entails gamma, right? But this follows from this. So we need this. So we get then that this relation here is a pre-order, reflexive and transitive. And we also get that the forcing relation for atoms, so A is an atom, is monotone, right? And now we extend, just using the definition of forcing here, we extend the forcing to propositions, but also to context. So we also have forcing of context, right? Which is the conjunction of this. And now we can establish this equivalence, or that's the main lemma to prove completeness, is to establish this equivalence by induction on propositions. Okay, and it's a nice little exercise to just prove this for implication. Yeah, so actually, it's quite good to prove it separate in both directions. So don't try to do both directions separate. And it's a very nice little proof. You see, there's a nice match between the semantics and the syntax. But what happens if we introduce disjunction? If you think about it, is it true? Okay, what is here? Yeah. Can it be true that gamma forces P or Q if and only if gamma proves P or Q? If you think about it, so this is defined in Kripke, gamma forces P or gamma forces Q, okay? Now gamma may just be P or Q, right? But while P or Q entails P or Q, it is not true that P or Q proves P, because that would be induction hypothesis. Yeah, I mean, this is the same as this by induction hypothesis, or P or Q proves Q, right? So this lemma here is going to fail if you introduce disjunction, and it also fails for false and for existentials. So Kripke models, what are the consequences of this? Kripke models are still complete for propositional logic, and there's a little trick. What you do is you define a subset of contexts which behave well with respect to disjunction and false, as they're called saturated contexts. And then you show that these saturated contexts form a model, right? And that's okay. But actually you need, at this point, you need the decidability of the probability relation. And so as soon as you go into predicate logic, this fails. And actually you can prove that completeness of Kripke models for intuitionistic predicate logic doesn't hold intuitionistically.
So what do you mean by doesn't hold intuitionistically?
You cannot prove it. Okay, you can prove, if you assume it, you can prove an assumption which is not provable in intuitionistic logic, namely Markov principle.
You mean to prove completeness of Pedagogic intuitionistic logic, you need to use classical reasoning at meta level?
Yes, but But you have to say for Kripke models, because this is not a defect of the logic, it's a defect of Kripke models. The Kripke models are not good enough. Yeah?
If you want to do meta proofs intuitionistically.
Yeah, or if you want to have a complete semantics for intuitionistic predicate logic, which is provable complete. In intuitionistic logic, which goes without saying for me, right?
Okay.
Yeah. And if you look at it, what is wrong with Kripke semantics?
Is that a question?
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm so used to Kripke semantics that it's difficult for me to say what's wrong with it.
Yeah, but if you think about it, we use the structure of the words only to establish to reason about implication, right?
Yeah.
I mean, for conjunction, this is absolutely fine, but as we see here, there is a problem with disjunction, right? And the problem is false, actually, all of it is existential. So I'm saying the Kripke interpretation of disjunction is bad. Yeah. And how can we fix it? Now, I said before, these are Kripke models. But if you have studied a little, I mean, if you view from the point of category theory, these are a simple case of a pre-sheaf. So what's actually a pre-sheaf is very similar, but that instead of going into prop here, you go into set, yeah? And you need some more laws. It's a pre-sheaf is a contravariant functor. So you replace pre-orders by categories. Do you know what categories are?
Not at all.
Oh, okay. Okay, so a category is a glorified pre-order, okay? It's a pre-order where you care about the proofs, and it's a pre-order, and at the same time, it's a monoid, okay? And the very simple category is a category of sets, where the objects are sets and the morphisms are functions. So it's worthwhile to study category theory, because I think you can either learn category theory or reinvent it. These are the two options. Anyway, I you don't have to know what categories are, but you see there is a word tree here, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the solution is by getting rid of the pre. And sheaves are due to Grothendieck. So Grothendieck is better than Kripke, I'm saying, okay? So what is it actually? Let me just, what is a Grothendieck model or a Bethe model or whatever? I think it's related to Bethe models. I'm not actually 100% sure about the historical correctness of the statement. So Grothendieck model is a Kripke model plus something else, plus. Yeah. So you put more structure in. And what is this extra structure? The structure is basically, actually in Grothendieck's formulation, the structure comes from topology. Yeah. But I can make it, I can give a more sort of intuitive explanation. It's like, if you have a world here, and then you have these whole futures, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Then maybe you have a set of futures, like this. And wherever you go, you will end up in one of these futures. It doesn't really matter. You cannot, if you go into the future, you will always end up in this area here. It's also called a bar. Yeah. Or cover. That's right. That has to do with category theory. That's cover, open cover. So that's the idea. And how can we formalize it? We can say, okay, we have a relation cover. Do I write it this way or the other way around? Yeah. So a word is covered by a C, where C is a set of words. So a predicate on words, right? And then this is a predicate. So we say, give me a word and a set of word, I tell you then whether the set of word covers the words we started in.
And the intuition between cover is?
Is that a cover covers a word if it's unavoidable that if you go into the future, if you learn more things, eventually you end up in this cover. Yeah.
Okay, so it's a set of words, which is all the possible futures for my word.
Yeah. Okay, I give some rules. This is the idea. This is not the definition, okay?
Sure.
Yeah, yeah. The idea, the rules are the following. A word is covered by all its futures. Let's see, all W prime, where W prime is the future, is always on the left of W. Yeah, that's the first one. The second one is, if you have a cover and you go into the future, so you have a word which is in the future. By the way, the fact that the future is on the left has also to do with category theory. But then the subset of words which is the future still, so the W prime in C, so that W double prime is actually a future of W prime, is a cover of W prime. Okay, yeah. So in other words, if I go in the future and I look at the subset of the cover, which is my own future, then this is a cover of this world here, right? So here I have W, I go into the future, and now I cut out the part of the cover, which is my own future, then this is a cover. Okay. And the third rule is a transitivity rule. If I have a cover and for every word in the cover, I have a cover. Okay, that's a let's say there's a, oops, what have I done now? Okay, there is a CW prime, which is a cover, then the union of these is a cover of all, of all CW prime, okay?
Mm-hmm.
That is in the origin cover. So basically, If I have a cover for each word in the cover, I take them all together, I get a new cover. Okay. And then I need to relate it also to my forcing relation. And I'm saying basically, if I have a cover and there is a proposition. So for all words in my cover, a proposition or atomic proposition, I talk about only atoms in the moment, then W also forces A. So what does this mean? It means if it's unavoidable that A will be forced, then we know already it must be forced now. That is a paste condition, a sheaf condition.
Sorry, I don't see the intuition here.
The intuition is, if there is a proposition, atom, which
yes.
is, we have a cover. So we will end up in this cover. Yeah.
Yes.
And everywhere in this cover, this proposition holds, this atom holds, then it holds already now. Then we know already it must be true because it's unavoidable to become true, right?
So we can see the future.
Yeah, I mean, we're good enough, our forcing relation is good enough that as it's unavoidable that something becomes true, then we know it already, because yeah, we know it's unavoidable. So I mean, I like, if I reason with you, if I say, okay, now assume this, and this is a complete enumeration of all the possibilities, and all ways a proposition holds, you say, yeah, I know, it's already true, right? I mean, that's the intuition.
Well, it's a bit like it's necessarily true, like there's no other way.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. It's actually to do with this analysis of all possible cases. So if you have a Kripke model with a cover relation which satisfies this condition, then it's a Grothendieck relation, Grothendieck model, or it's a special case of a sheaf model. Special case because we go into prop, and for a sheaf model we would go into set. I mean, that's a bit more sophisticated. So yeah, these sheaf models were actually came from topology, but then people realized that this is actually a really, really the most natural semantics for intuitionistic logic. Yeah. And now I can also say what is W forces P or Q. Is now defined as there exists a cover. So C is C this way around. C covers W, and for all W prime in C, it forces either P or Q. So what we say, if it's unavoidable that one of them becomes true, then we believe P or Q. And falsum is defined if the world is covered by the empty cover. So if you want to construct the you want to construct the universal Grothendieck model, okay? So it goes actually, it's an extension of the construction for the universal Kripke model, which we have already discussed. What we need to do is we need to define the cover relation, right? And this is let me see. I hope I get it right. What was it? Oh yeah. If gamma, so there's a basic. It's an inductive definition. If gamma covers, if gamma proves P or Q, and and C0 now we okay, hang on, that's the wrong way around. C0 is a cover for gamma P, sorry, and and C1 is a cover of gamma Q, then gamma is covered by C0 union C1. And for false, we say if gamma proves false, then every cover, then gamma is covered by any set of words. So this cover is now defined. It's an inductive definition, like derivability. Mm-hmm. And with this definition, then you can actually prove, this theorem. I mean that gamma proves P if and only if gamma forces P. And hence you can prove completeness. And it also works for predicate logic. And you don't need any. It's intuitionistically provable. So that is happening a lot in intuitionistic logic, that something which is not provable, and you think, okay, oh, this is really bad, yeah. Like even Kripke models are not provably complete, but it's just because you haven't put enough information into the model. And actually, it turns out that understanding these type of models, these sheaf models, is useful for other things as well. So it's a very natural, a very important structure.
What is a good source for this kind of information? Is there any?
You can talk to me, you know? I mean.
And if I want to read something?
I don't know. I mean, you find various, the Tolstoy von Dahlen book on intuitionism, which is quite thick and extremely expensive, but I'm sure you find it on the internet, which does everything in a bit of a old-fashioned way, I would say. Yeah. Yeah, there's nothing which really, in my view, I can think about it, but I really don't know. I'm not very good with references, to be honest.
So where did you get this information from?
By talking to people. I mean, Thierry Coucon is very useful, but lots of other people. And then I played around myself, and I was actually interesting. I studied this when I was trying to understand what's called normalization by evaluation, right? Which is so. By evaluation, or NBE, which is a way to compute normal forms of lambda terms by going through the semantics. Yeah? So you have here the syntactic lambda terms, and here you have the semantics. And what you do is you have a semantics which is complete, so you can go back. And NBE is you go, you take a lambda term, you evaluate it in the semantics, and then, so this I call, what is this called, quote. You go back from the semantics into the syntax. But because you went through the semantics, all the things which are equal have been squeezed together, and then they are identified, so you compute a normal form, right? And the semantics for normal NBE is Kripke, or no, pre-sheaves, which are, as I say, glorified Kripke models. Yeah? But then we wanted to do it for this junction, and then we need sheaves. And there's a paper. But that requires a little bit of category theory that we do this paper with Martin Hoffman and some other people where we do this NBE. So it's actually was the first paper where we show that the lambda calculus with plus with co-products is decidable. It was a new result, and we used this, these sheaves. And when I try to explain this construction, I find it always useful to strip the complexity, reduce the complexity, and instead of pre-sheaves, then I use Kripke. And sheaves, I use what I call Grothendieck models.
So this is standard terminology, Grothendieck models.
No, I made it up.
Oh, you made it up.
I think some other people use the same term. So maybe I didn't make it up. I made it just up that I made it up. I'm not sure.
And all the proofs of completeness go through intuitionistically as well, right?
Yeah, that's the point.
That's the whole point.
Yeah. I mean, otherwise, they are not valid in my point of view. They're done by cheating.
That's a slightly different perspective for me, because most people I know, they study intuitionistic logic, but when they do meta theory, completeness, they feel free to use classical logic as much as they want.
Yeah. So how do I? Hang on. Yes, these are traitors, I know. I mean. Yeah.
Well, that's the Russian school of intuitionistic logic.
Yeah. So. Oh, here, stop sharing on. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, nothing against Russians. I mean, they're very clever people, as we know. But maybe not always very principled. So.
All right. So from what I get from you, that if you want to understand these things really deeply, then category theory helps a lot.
Yeah, I mean, but I think category theory, if you want to understand something very deeply, I think you need category theory. Well, let me be a bit more careful. I mean, okay, there are hackers, and hackers may come get away without ever doing category theory, right? I mean, in mathematics, you also have hackers, right? They're like, but if you want to like see the bigger picture, and this is also called structural mathematics. Yeah, if you want to see the structure, then there is no alternative to category theory. I don't know any.
So I'd better start learning. What is
Yeah, I can give you. I have some lecture notes which I should really revise. I'm sure there are lots of errors in them, but I can still share them with you.
Would be nice.
Okay. Yeah. And I also they're a bit unfinished. I use them for a course for the Midland Graduate School. And I wrote some lecture notes, but I didn't really finish them. But I wanted to turn them into a book. I have a title already, which is always very important, right? It's called Categories for the Lazy Functional Programmer, right? Because that's, you know, there's this lazy functional languages, and the book on category theory is Category for the Working Mathematician by Saunders McLean. Yeah? And I'm not trying to compete with Saunders, so I call mine Categories for the Lazy Functional Programmer, which is a bit of a word game. Right?
And what is your quarrel with the McLean book?
Nothing, no. It's for mathematicians, and it's yeah. I don't have a quarrel with Saunders McLean, obviously. I mean, you know about Saunders McLean? I
Not
hear.
much. Not much.
Yeah. I have a story. I met him once. He was 92 already, I think, and I was just finished my PhD, and I went to one of my first conferences, which was a nice conference, Category Theory in Computer Science, or for computer science, I don't know. I was in Cambridge, and there was Saunders McLean. Yeah, and I mean, he is like guy who invented category theory and everything. So I wouldn't go anywhere close to him. I was like so impressed with his, I mean, because he's so famous, right? You don't go there and say, "Hey, Saunders, how are you?" You know, it wasn't. Yeah. But then we had this dinner with long tables in this like Harry Potter style dining hall, yeah. And who ends up sitting directly opposite me? Saunders McLean, yeah. And here, may I introduce myself? Like, yeah, and I'm Thorsten Altenkirch. And then he says, "Oh, you come from Germany." And then he starts talking German to me. I didn't know at this point. How come you speak German? Ah, he says, "You know, I was a PhD student in Göttingen. Hilbert was my supervisor." Yeah, and actually, Gensen, I was together with Gensen. Oh, I see.
Oh, okay. Okay, it's look, it's a slightly different perspective for me because I'm mostly speaking to people who are probably originally model logicians and who study intuitionistic logic and feel completely free to use classical reasoning and meta theory.
Yeah, I know there are lots of these traitors. I mean, sorry.
That's why I kind of wanted your point of view because I always remember that you had a slightly different approach from what I'm familiar with. Why is it now those connections between functional programming and intuitionistic logic? So that's something I don't completely understand at all.
Yeah, I mean, this is basically type theory, right? I mean, the point is actually the right way to do intuitionistic logic is just to do type theory. I mean, because type theory gives you construction on types, and you can use types to also model propositions. So it's just propositions are particular types which come from the translation of what traditional propositional formulas. But actually, okay, in type theory, you have a more expressive language. I mean, first of all, you don't need to introduce everything twice, yeah. I mean, so okay, I said, okay, we have implication and we model implication by functions. So that's like having two things, just one, your functions, end of story, right? I mean, no need to do everything twice, yeah. So in types, they do everything once. I mean, you just say we have functions, and if you want to express implication, you just use a function. Okay, what else? I mean, it seems to be. But the nice thing is, in type theory, you can there is a difference. Okay, so you can so okay in modern type theory, not every type is a proposition. But a type which has at most one inhabitant, you know, there's no information in the elements. Yeah? Only the fact whether the type is inhabitant, at most one element, classically it's empty or a one element type, but intuitionistically you don't know, right? It's not necessarily just one of the two. It's whatever, but a proposition cannot have been more than one element, so there's no information in the proposition. Now there are two ways to model existentials. no, I mean, actually, existentials should be usually return a proposition. Yeah. So you can model existential by just saying, what is evidence for exist an element of A such as PX holds is a pair of the element and the proof that the property holds. But now we have to forget the identity. We have to put it in a black sack, basically, because because if you see the element, the witness, there will be more than one usually, yeah, and then it's not a proposition. So we have to put it into the black sack to make it a proposition, right? So that's existence, which you know, right? But there is another thing, which is a sigma type, which is just a dependent pair. And the sigma type is not a proposition, but it gives you the information about the choice, yeah? So in a way, if you translate existential with sigma, you can prove the axiom of choice, which is a bit of cheating. But if you translate it with exist, then you get the traditional axiom of choice and with all its consequences. Excluding middle is a consequence of choice, right? Diaconescu. But it's nice because in many situations you want to make this difference, whether you have actually a mere existence or whether you actually have a witness. And so that's a it's in many ways a more expressive language type theory. So I would find it impossible to do. So mathematics in predicate logic seems to be a cheat. Yeah. So I mean, I always would use types. It's a cheat because it's an inappropriate language to do mathematics. Yeah. So I would always use type theory.
But type theory is much richer, right?
Yeah, like, it's richer where you need it, right? Yeah. But actually, it's very, very small in a way because you have these constructions on types, and you get the logic for free. Yeah? There's no need. I mean, to introduce like if you do like some sort of set theory, first introduce the predicate logic, and then you introduce all the constructions on sets. That's not necessary. There's just one. We just define type theory, and then logic is included. It comes for free. That is very useful.
Because in classical logic, right, it's also true. You can do everything in set theory, right?
Yes.
But you wouldn't want to because it's not very convenient.
Yes, it also has another disadvantage, which is, I mean, for me, set theory is like a machine language, like assembly language, yeah, low level. Yeah. And so one of the problems of set theory, apart from usually being classical and having nasty axioms like the axiom of choice and excluded middle, apart from this, I mean, let's ignore this. There's something else which is wrong with set theory. And that is that you talk about elements. Right, you talk about elements in isolation of the set they belong to, which I think is you don't actually want to do this, right? If I say for all natural numbers something holds in set theory, it would be for all sets which turn out to be natural numbers, this holds, right? It's very weird. I don't want to talk about all sets, right? I just want to talk about natural numbers. So that's already weird, but it gets worse. Now, in set theory, because we can talk about elements in isolation to their type, so to say, we can observe the encoding. So for example, let's say we have two different definitions of the natural numbers. There are actually two. There is one due to Zermelo and one from Neumann. And I can write a predicate which distinguishes the two. I say, is one an element of three? A really stupid question. One and three are numbers, so why would one be an element of three? Yeah, but this proposition distinguishes two different encodings of the natural numbers. It has nothing to do with numbers. It's just you look into the representation, which means that set theory cannot be representation independent. Yeah, everything you can always just observe the encoding, which is a bad thing. In type theory, you can't. In type theory, if I define the type of natural numbers, an element is always a natural number, and I cannot look at the natural number in isolation of its type. So I cannot express this predicate which distinguishes, for example, two different representations of the natural numbers, like that's a union binary. I cannot write this down. Everything in type theory is automatic structural. Yeah? You only can use structural principles. And this now leads us to Vladimir Vovotsky and univalence, because I don't know the fit of Vovotsky. I mean, he's...
I've heard the name, but I don't know anything about him.
I mean, he's Russian. I mean, he was Russian. I mean, he died and he got a field medal. I mean, that's usually quite good. But he suggested this univalence principle, which he actually also got from topology, but from algebraic topology. So he suggested this univalence principle, which basically says that two types, which are, let's say, isomorphic, so they're one-to-one correspondence. That's a bit imprecise what I say, but there are two types which are in a one-to-one correspondence, like two different encoding of the natural numbers, then they're equal. And it makes sense, because in type theory, you cannot observe the differences between equivalent representations. So hence, all what I can see are the extensional properties, yeah, and hence two objects, two types which have the same extensional properties, they're the same thing, the same object. Yeah, because we don't want to look inside, yeah, we only look from outside, and if they look the same from outside, then they are the same, because we don't care about how things are defined. Yeah.
I'm not sure I get the whole point you're making, but yeah. Sorry, I'm very bad in the sense that I think set theoretically and classically all the time.
Sure. Quite natural.
Why do you say it's natural if you believe it's actually unnatural?
It's unnatural, but what you get educated in, right? I mean, you get brainwashed into classical logic and set theory.
But it's not just brainwashing; it's also using your intuition about your everyday world when you think about mathematical objects. Right?
I mean, I do this as well. I mean, when I do, I also use my intuition. Actually, what I find very useful for me is intuition coming from programming. Yeah. So that is, for me, a very important source of intuition about mathematical constructions.
How so?
For example, I mean, this idea of a function. Yeah. I mean, a function is something, you put something in, you get something out. It's a program, right? So all these things I'm talking about are programs, right? So they're programs which are very maybe sophisticated type system, but they're all programs. So I'm just so mathematics and programming is the same thing for me. I mean, yeah, so actually, maybe this is historically has to do with the first major sort of application of mathematics was natural science, like Newton and so on, all these application in ballistic calculus and so on. Yeah, so then I think it was natural that the metaphor for mathematics was the real world, right? Because that's the main application. But now we have computer science, and computer science actually is now maybe also maybe eclipses now natural science as an application of mathematics, right? So it's a new metaphor which comes from a different application with different area to which you apply mathematics. So that feeds back, you know. This idea that mathematics is completely independent of what you do with it is not true, right? So the idea of using computer, I mean programming or computer science or whatever you want to call it, changes the way you do mathematics. And it goes actually, I think it goes deeper. So although that we have, this feeds back in also into natural science, yeah? That we have a different paradigm of what is a physical model. Because for me, a physical model is like a computer game which perfectly simulates reality. Yeah? I mean, if you want to explain a physical phenomenon, you find a way as you can simulate it, and then you understood it, right? And I think this is actually maybe useful, but I know that actually, I mean, maybe that's not that ideas from type theory are now type theory and actually higher category theory, which is another thing, now is used by people to try to formulate the issues of like quantum gravity and so on. So I think actually that the old mathematics is one of the reasons why we are stuck in physics and in like quantum gravity and stuff like this. Because we haven't understood. I think to this paradigm or this idea that the universe is basically a computational engine. We're only interested in how it computes. Maybe more useful than this old idea of this Platonic perfection, which is a bit of an illusion.
So you think about lots of philosophy as well.
Yeah, I'm not really a philosopher, because philosophers always know the history of ideas, and I'm interested in the ideas and only secondary with their history, to be honest. So I'm not a philosopher. DIY philosopher. Thank you.
Well, a different approach is the philosophy. You don't have to know all the history.
Okay, I mean academic philosophy, yeah, is very focused on the history of ideas.
So if I wanted to kind of learn a bit more details and a bit more systematically about these issues, semantics, adequate semantics for intuitionistic logic, relation to category theory, to all this topological construction, so would you be able to suggest some reason to do, or with occasionally consulting you if I get stuck? Would there be some kind of...
Let me think about it, but I don't know, because the problem is that I don't really like what other people write, right? So
Well, fair enough.
But I can, okay, I give you, I mean, I don't know whether this is exactly what you want, but I can give you certainly, I have some notes on category theory. I also have some notes on type theory, which I'm just turning into a book. So I can give you these, because then at least I'm confident. I mean, I don't even like the things I've written if they are in the past, right? But they're usually better than what, I mean, I don't want to sound arrogant, but it's just the way I feel. Yeah. So whenever I look at something and then I think, oh no, 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 it's not the way it should be told. You know, I'm not too awkward or whatever. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that I do everything better, but I do everything in a way that I like it better. That's all.
Okay, so you would be able to share your notes on category theory on.
Yeah, I'll send you by email. Yeah, okay, or yeah.
Okay, and you don't mind if I occasionally ask you questions?
No, not at all. I like to answer questions.
Just I'm now getting involved in the project on predicate intuitionistic logic and predicate model logic.
Oh, yeah.
But from very classical Russian school point of view.
Yeah.
So I wanted to try to explore somewhat different approaches and points of view.
Yeah. But it's interesting, like, Vygotsky was obviously a classical mathematician, right? But I think he got more and more interested into intuitionistic mathematics. He did the first proof of soundness of consistency of homotropy type theory, and this was classical, used axiom of choice. Yeah. And this is another example that has been fixed now, yeah. But it is a challenge, but in this case, it was actually a challenge which also has a practical, very important practical implication, because Vygotsky's proof of consistency, because it's classical, it doesn't give us any hint how to compute this in homotropy type theory. But now, since we have a constructive model, the cubical set interpretation, we also know how to run the programs. It feels good, and it's useful. So it's a good combination.
What exactly is homotopy type theory?
Yeah, homotopy type theory is, I sent you an article about Martin Hoffman. I don't know whether you know, he died a few years ago. He was hill walking in Japan in the winter, and he got lost. I just wrote a very, very introductory article for special issue, it's for the housewife, okay, on the level of housewife, but maybe it's useful. You're not a housewife, okay. In a nutshell, it's related to what I said. So Vygotsky comes from algebraic topology, in particular homotopy theory. And homotopy theory is, I don't know whether you know anything about it, I didn't know much about it, is a very abstract way to do topological spaces. You look at topological spaces from a sort of very categorical point of view, very abstract point of view. In a way, you could say you really look at the groups of paths on the surface of a geometric object in any dimension. But anyway, and Vygotsky, as I understand it, I don't know the details. I mean, obviously, he gets this field medal because he proved an open assumption. But I mean, the important thing about Vladimir was that he was very much somebody who thinks out of the box. Yeah. So he's a very interesting guy. I mean, he never finished his undergraduate degree, but then he got, so he observed that when he thinks about mathematical construction in general, that the analogy with topological spaces in the sense of homotopy theory is much better than using sets. Yeah? So not constructivity, but exactly this idea of doing things structural, not look at the elements, but look at the structure. Yeah. And so he had this idea of formulating foundations of mathematics based on this idea. And then he found out there is this thing called type theory, Martin Löf, and with implementations like Coq, and he realized that this is maybe a vehicle for him to express this intuition, and that then led to homotopy type theory. There's a book about homotopy type theory which I was involved writing as well, so I can. It's free. It's online.
So it's basically some kind of idea for the foundations of mathematics.
Yeah, yeah, it's the proper foundations of mathematics.
You would say?
Yes. True. I mean, yeah, it's not perfect because, okay, it's obviously evolving, right? So since this book was written, we have made lots of progress, right? So it's already, it has always, as it happens, things move on, right? So, but yeah.
But for intuitionistic mathematics, you're saying Trollstra and Van Dalen's book is...
Yeah, two books. Two books.
Volumes, yeah?
Yeah, it's quite thick, and I wouldn't tell it
thick
like
as
this.
Thick or thick as in not very smart?
No, sorry. I mean, it's very smart. I mean, you have to see everything in the context of the time, and obviously that was a big achievement, right? Both are... Also, yeah, not alive anymore. But no, it's there are things which I really don't like about the presentation in this book. But it's a great book. I mean, books.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Thorsten.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks for the introduction. Yeah. I'll definitely look at your lecture notes. And I'll have a question.
Sure, yes. Oh, by the way, I've recorded this, so do you mind if I put it on YouTube or?
Not at all.
Okay. Yeah.
Would be nice to have the tape as well. So if it's on YouTube, just download.
Yeah, I'll send you the link, okay. If I manage, let's see, I haven't. Maybe it all goes wrong, so I don't know.
Sure.
Okay, yeah, talk to you another time.
You're Thank welcome. You very Anytime. Much. Yeah. Looking forward. Thanks a lot for your help.
Okay. Bye.
Have a good day. Bye.